Good, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. Today we're back with Game of Thrones, and we got a history and lore for season 4. Listen, if you haven't checked out my last history and lore videos for season 3, I'm doing this right after I'm recording them. I literally recorded them back to back because I already finished season 3 and 4 at the time of recording. You know, I'm saying these two. So, in that, I said I ordered some food. So, as soon as it comes in, I'm going to grab the food and I'm bring it up here and I'm a grub. You know what I'm saying? But that's enough talking. Let's get into this. But before we do, make sure you thumbs up and subscribe and let's get it. Got Mr. Pedro Pascal. Say goodbye to that.
She was not the most beautiful woman in the world, or even in Dorne. But rare for a woman from our land, her flower came with no thorns. She was kind and clever, with a gentle heart. I loved her. I feared for her. For years I fended off lesser men from her. But when Rhaegar came, even I failed. She was beautiful, for our prince of the Seven Kingdoms. Mother had worked so hard to secure the match, how could Elia not accept it? They were wed, and he took her from her home, from those who loved her and would die for her, and locked her in his red keep, above his sty of a city surrounded by false friends. She bore him a daughter and a son, though each almost cost her her life. Elia loved Rhaegar. She obeyed him, and he chose to steal away Lyanna's star. Pale northern girl whose veins ran with ice like honor. Instead of disciplining his faithless son, King Ares executed the Starks when they came seeking justice and ignited a revolt. I know how the Maesters describe the war now, but calling it Robert's Rebellion does not change what it was. The war they usurped. Dorne sided with the Crown, for when we swear oaths, we keep them. We needed no threats from King Ares. Though he made them anyway, locking Elia and her children in the Red Keep to ensure our loyalty. Even in his madness, he knew that no true Dornishman would ever take up arms against our beloved princess, and that we would fight to the death for whichever side she was on. At the Trident, Dorne lost 10,000 men and 2 princes, my uncle in the King's Guard, and Elia's gallant husband, Prince Rhaegar, who was too slow or too arrogant. As Robert's army marched on King's Landing, the Mad King sent his own wife and child away, but kept my sister and hers inside. In his madness, Ares thought that the Dornish had betrayed his son at the Trident, and was only too happy to welcome his one true friend back into his ranks, Tywin Lannister. Lord Tywin's army sacked his friend's city, while Lord Tywin's son murdered the king he'd sworn to protect. All this could have been forgiven. War is terrible, and men must become terrible to wage it. But the Lannisters knew that as long as my sister and her children, Prince Rhaegar's heirs, lived, no usurper could safely sit the throne. So Lord Tywin's dog, Sir Gregor Clegane, the Mountain, made Elia watch as he murdered her daughter and dashed her infant son's head against a wall. Then, with her baby's blood still in his hands, he raped my sister and murdered her. When Lord Tywin later presented their bodies to Robert Baratheon wrapped in pretty Lannister cloaks, I have been told the red color graciously hid the blood from men's eyes.
the Targaryen stock of fire and blood. In Dorne, our blood is fire. Robert Baratheon had dared set foot in Dorne during his reign, he would have lost the foot. And it is not even him we blame for Elia. The Lannisters think their gold buys them power. The Lannisters think their mountain buys them strength. But if they want peace, they cannot buy it with mountains of gold or one mountain of steel. They must pay.
The mountain got a hold that dude, but you wanted to keep like, bro, talk your shit before and after, not during, my guy.
But Aegon came to Westeros with fire and blood, and hammered six kingdoms into one. Fire he undoubtedly ruled, as the kings of the Rock, Reach, and Iron Islands learned. But blood has never been in short supply here, ever since the first man carried a crown into Westeros. This first king united his people against the children of the forest and is supposedly buried in the north, a victim of a war he started. The first ruler of this land and the first to die on his throne, but not nearly the last. For thousands of years afterwards, a thousand kings rose and fell, dying in their beds, in their battles, in their guards' and mistresses' arms. The age of heroes sounds pretty until you realize what makes a hero. Killing the enemies of his king. And to a king, there is no greater enemy than other kings. The Starks and Boltons, the Gardeners and Stormkings, the Ironborn and everyone else. Even the mighty Targaryens were not immune from shortened reigns. Aegon's own son, Maegor the Cruel, was killed by the very Iron Throne his father had forged, if you believe the tales. If you don't, then perhaps the Cruel is not a wise name for a king to earn. Daeron, first of his name, tried to finish his ancestors' work and bring Dorne into the fold. For his efforts, he lost 60,000 men and his own life.
Golly.
During the great Targaryen civil war, known as the Dance of the Dragons, a king and queen each vied for the throne, dividing their house and its dragons against each other. Eventually, queen was fed to her rival's dragon while her son watched, and the victorious king soon died of his own wounds. By the war's end, King's Landing was smashed, cities razed and sacked, never to be rebuilt, and dragons had faded from this world. Decades later, Aegon the Unworthy legitimized all his bastards on his deathbed. Inevitably, the greatest of these, Daemon Blackfyre, declared himself the rightful heir and ignited yet another war for the crown. After much bloodshed, Daemon was killed by an alliance of his half-brothers on the Red Grass Field. All the same, his descendants continued to threaten the Targaryens until half a century later, when Barristan the Bold slew Maelys the Monstrous on the Stepstones, extinguishing Daemon's line. Given such an illustrious history, need we be so shocked by regicide? A war of five kings can end only one way, with the death of four. Yet even in times of peace, a wise ruler knows that when men bend the knee to a king, too often they rise holding daggers.
That was a fire transition right there. But ain't the war to five kings already like... Ain't that already, Patton, man. The arms of passion, but poison is cold, calculating. Poison is the thought that wakes you in the morning. That should look like a gif I got someone.
You watch your victim die a thousand times before you ever offer him that weakly taste. Is a man's hate so inferior to a woman's that we are to be denied such a weapon? When I was a boy of 16, a great lord caught me with his mistress. He should have been honored. Instead, fat old fool challenged me to a duel, thanks to my age and status, only to first blood. But his mistress and his wife warned me which of my parts he intended to draw first blood from. He was strong and fierce, but slow. I cut him quickly, and the duel ended with honor satisfied.
Then oh, that's how you be doing? Festered, and he died. Oh, that's how you be doing? Okay. Okay.
Never fails as if a single serpent was all I knew of venom. Essence of nightshade is the gentlest of poisons. A drop dissolved into wine will slow a pounding heart and stop a hand from shaking. 3 drops will grant a night of deep and dreamless sleep. 10 drops, and you will have a sleep that does not end. Basilisk blood. It will give cooked meat a savory smell. But if eaten, it produces violent madness in beasts as well as men. A mouse will attack a lion after a taste of basilisk blood. But to a man who knows his art, is not passion a form of madness? Widow's blood forces a man's bladder and bowels to fail. Drowns his own presence.
Ain't that what got Joffrey out of here?
He dies in agony, which will not appear unusual if the victim is old or sickly. A favorite tool of impatient heirs.
Well, if that's what got Joffrey up out of here, I'm glad it was agony.
That's flattery coming from you southerners that kneel to a pig if your daddy did. We call ourselves the free folk, or at least most of us won't kill you for calling us so. Some will, aye. But that's just the way of it in the true north, beyond your great white wall, where your laws and kingdoms end, and men live free and die cold. For we live close to our land, and she's a terrible wife. Fail to obey her, and she kills you. On the frozen shore, so deep is the snow that men ride chariots made of walrus bones, pulled by packs of dogs. The Hornfords have it easy in the mountains. The cold so hardens and blackens the soles of their feet that they don't even need boots. The cave people spend their lives in the dark, doing God's know what with God's know who. The Thens have one of the only nice bits of land up there.
The Thens, about crazy as hell, dude.
Made end of the frost tanks with game, copper, and tin for shiny bronze weapons. Better than the rusted old blades most of us have. With such advantages, they could be a generous, friendly race. They're not. As young boys, they burn their faces and rub ash and dirt into their wounds. Scars more than their face, I think. They follow their Magnar, who's the kind of man who can rule these kinds of men. I know what you southerners are thinking, and no, the Magnar is not a king, more like their god, though not one you'd care to follow if you don't sleep with your eyes open. And then there are the giants, a proud race as old as the Frostfangs and about as tough. They speak the old tongue when they speak at all, though they understand more common than they let on. They're not the monsters you southerners think. Once I was caught in a winter storm so cold, I knew it'd freeze to death before it broke. Lucky for me, I stumbled on a sleeping giant, cut open her belly, and crawled right up inside her. Kept me warm enough, but the stink nearly done me. The worst thing was, when she woke up, she took me for her babe. Tackled me for 3 whole moons before I could get away.
Man, I better hurry up with this food, dude. Yeah, like, you're gonna have to catch me. Remember when I was talking about, last time I was talking about Horizon Zero Dawn and Horizon Forbidden West? Man, it's kind of like, I don't know if I ever made this comparison. He kind of like, Marshall Farshot? Marshall? Listen, when you play Horizon Forbidden West, when you're about to first go into Nock territory, and you have to speak to a former Karja. That's kind of like the same vein as the Wildlands or Free Folk. You know what I'm saying? And also, one thing, I might have to rewatch that scene, or just like the interactions. But if you're a former crow, wouldn't you know that there's only 2 or 3 castles still operational? Unless that was a recent, you know, development. But know that there's only 2 or 3 castles operational on the wall, and that, you know what I'm saying, they don't have thousands of people like John was saying.
Justice is a funny thing. For the poor is what keeps them alive and starving, depending on how the local.
All right, this shit pissing me off. My eye keep twitching, dude. For the rich, gotta look this up. Okay, well, alright. This saying being tired and stressed. I ain't really stressed, but I am tired as shit, dude. Facts. Yeah, exactly. Sloping down towards it like a woman's thighs. After a few days, they say the sky starts calling to you. Men jump with smiles on their faces, expecting the wind to lift them to the sky. It doesn't. To think Lord Tyrion was one tit-shaped cloud away from death. Lucky for him, he was highborn.
If your family honor goes back hundreds of years to a time when your ancestors hit other men harder than they were hit, you have another option. Trial by combat. You either fight your accuser, or you both pick champions to fight on your behalf, and the gods will favor the righteous man. As long as he's also the strongest, the quickest, or the luckiest. Once in a long while, you may get two real high-born shits having a go at each other. And one of them might be fool enough to demand a trial by seven. Exactly how it sounds. Seven men against seven men. Makes for a good show, I guess. But any man who's been in battle knows that the more men involved, the less skill needed, the more chance of accidents. Just ask that Targaryen prince who got his head staved in by his brother all those years ago. And all for some hitch night. If you ever find yourself arrested in the Seven Kingdoms, just remember that justice is up to the judge. Beg him for forgiveness, or pay him for it, or ask to be allowed to take the black. But remember that he doesn't have to let you. There are plenty of lords out there who think hands and heads are great decorations for their spikes. The Septons claim that justice is of the gods. Nice of them to keep it up there to themselves.